I have got the opportunity of interacting with a lot of Germans or a lot of Japanese, Chinese people. They do not speak good English because it is not their mother tongue. It is not their native language, and they are not shy about it. I mean, they are more than proud about their mother tongue, and they are confident in whatever they are speaking. They speak it slow, they speak it well. On the contrary, unfortunately, what's happened in India is English has become a sort of a status symbol, that if you're speaking fluent English, if you're speaking great English, then of course you're very well educated, and you know, your mother tongue takes a backseat.
I'm starting with this new series by the name of #doers. A doer is a person who does something. We call them karta in Hindi. A doer is a person who acts rather than merely talking or thinking. The person that I've invited today to talk on the first episode of #doers is a chartered accountant. He's a young boy who has fabulous command over English. His free CA classes were acknowledged by Tech Talks. He has been invited to New York to deliver a speech on the platform of TED. I'm very excited to talk to him. Let's quickly jump into the conversation. Hi.
Hi.
Okay, Aryan, please tell me, what do you do exactly? People would want to know. The nation wants to know.
The nation wants to know. Oh my God. Okay, so what I exactly do is, basically, I'm a chartered accountant by qualification. And after I became a chartered accountant, I started working in a Big Four, and then started working in a second Big Four, continued there for some years. And then now finally I am in the industry. Ek company mein abhi job kar raha hun. So yeah, that is what is happening as of now.
Okay. How many attempts did you clear your CA? What age did you become CA? That is one favorite question of most of the people who want to do CA.
And I mean, if you see the students today, they are becoming chartered accountants at the age of 20, 20 and a half, 21. But I was not that fortunate. I think I became CA when I was 22 and a half, or almost reaching 23.
You were very fortunate. Yeah. You were very
I started a little late. Nowadays students start very early, but I started a little late. I completed my chartered accountancy at almost 22 and a half, 23. Final scale, I took two attempts because I knew that I'll not be able to do it in one attempt. So one group in one attempt and the second group in second attempt, and I cleared it that time. But okay. I mean, as luck would also have it, I think that period was the time when we had one of the highest pass percentages. So just got through, I think so.
Okay. Yeah, and about YouTube, you're doing pretty well on YouTube also. So that is something different. And how are you managing the two things together? Because a lot of our younger generation, they want to do YouTube, and along with that, they want to do other stuff also. So you are one very good example of that. You're almost about to touch 1 lakh subscribers. I want to know, how do you manage these two things together?
Yeah, I think that's an interesting question. And it's been some time since I started YouTubing. I think it's almost two and a half years now. I started my channel. So now the channel is called Pathway to CA, but earlier it was called Serial Reviewer. So I just started it with the thought, anything that comes in my way, I'll review it and I'll just post random videos. But soon I realized that there was a need for CA students and students in general that could be catered to. So I started putting, you know, a few strategies, motivations and all. But when it comes to managing both of them, especially when you are either working in a Big Four or progressing in your career, that means it starts taking more time over there. So then you have very limited time left for something as serious as YouTube. And I'm telling this because you know how important it is to maintain the quality of content on YouTube. You just can't post random videos and expect that the audience will come back to you. So it is also a proper job, especially I think if you have crossed 50,000, 55,000 subscribers, if you're beyond that, then you need to maintain a certain amount of dignity on your channel, certain amount of quality on your channel, so that you know, people keep coming, and especially when you're teaching students, it's a little difficult. Most of the weekdays, if you see, I try at least in a week, I try to upload at least 3 videos, and one or two on the weekdays and one or two on the weekends. Weekends is pretty simple for me because I'm working and I really do not have much to do on Saturdays and Sundays. So I get some time off, but on weekdays in the evening, maybe a 10-minute video or 5-minute video. The only good part about how I record videos is I record them in one shot. So it doesn't really take so much time.
Wow. And that is not my case. intro takes 50 shots.
Oh my God, that is interesting. No, I actually have videos of 1.5 hours where I'm teaching. Basically, all those are one shot videos. So that is the good part about me. I just keep recording and I just somehow manage it. So that reduces your dependability on spending too much time. But yeah, it is a challenge, and you need to give full focus to both the things if you want to succeed in both of them.
You know
it
what,
is doable.
I realize one thing, that you speak quite good English, and I think that many of CA students do have this as a major problem, because CA, as you know, does not really have a college. So we don't train students on grooming much, and we do not teach them speaking skills. We don't focus on those things when we are becoming CA. We are in the process of becoming CA. So how did you learn your English? How are you so good in what you're doing? I mean, speaking, communication skills, your personality overall, because most of CA students, not just CA students, younger generation, if I talk about somebody who's aged between 20 to 25, would want to know this from you. That is why I'm asking you this question.
Well, firstly, thank you so much for the compliment. Especially, it means a lot coming from a person who herself is excelling in English and actually teaching a lot, many others, inspiring many others to speak in English. Yeah, and you're doing a great job, by the way. So for me, English speaking, I mean, see, now, as you mentioned, for CAs, there is no specific school or college where you actually go and learn, and you are taught there's no finishing. You do not have that finish. For me, what happened was, at an early age, I started reading a lot. So maybe when I was in sixth standard, I started reading books. And since then, I have been reading a lot. Not only that, early on, I started reading this newspaper called The Hindu. So that is the only newspaper I have read continuously. And that helped me improve my English, because quite a lot of other papers, you know, they use slang, so they do not use the best of sentences. So for me, reading out of a novel or reading out of that newspaper kickstarted the process of framing sentences correctly. Wow. Second thing, when it comes to speaking English,
definitely one new thing that I learned from you, because I have never been into newspapers, because whenever I read something sad, my entire day goes into the dustbin. That is why I avoid newspapers. But The Hindu is definitely one of the most respectable newspapers of our country. And that is one sure tip for everybody who's watching the video right now. Pick up The Hindu, start reading. Anything else that you did for your communication skills? Because as you know, my channel is all about communication, personality. So that is something I would want to extract out of you while I'm taking this interview.
Absolutely. So I think, there are two aspects to speaking good English. One is reading and understanding good English, and keeping English in your head while you're thinking and speaking. What Indians do a lot is they put Hindi in their mind or their mother tongue in their mind, translate it out into English. And then, of course, you're bound to make those errors that you make, and you're not going to have that flow of thought. When it comes to speaking English or spoken English, it is first important to construct what you are trying to or you want to convey in English, and be confident when you are speaking. You know, I've got the opportunity of interacting with a lot of Germans or a lot of Japanese, Chinese people.
How?
They do not,
through the job.
So they do not speak good English because it is not their mother tongue, it is not their native language, and they are not shy about it. I mean, they are more than proud about their mother tongue, and they are confident in whatever they are speaking. They speak it slow, they speak it well. On the contrary, unfortunately, what's happened in India is English has become a sort of a status symbol, that if you're speaking fluent English, if you're speaking great English, then of course you're very well educated, and you know, your mother tongue takes a back seat. Of course, now with the setup that we have in India, a lot of MNCs, and when you have to speak to people from other countries, you need decent English. But that doesn't mean you start getting scared or nervous or think too much about that. Oh, I have to speak in English, I have to speak good English, I have to speak fluent English. Because when that is in your mind, your thoughts won't flow out correctly. You will fumble, you will get scared. So there are many tips and tricks on how you can speak good English. You put it on your channel, and I also have done a few personality development videos. But I think the key success factor is having confidence and not being apprehensive about talking English in public. You just need to keep talking, keep speaking, and it will eventually come to you with practice.
You are very much correct in saying that in India, it has become a status symbol, which I do not know where it started from. It is surprising because, of course, English is not a native language, right? We're not supposed to be very good at it. But we still strive to be very good at it somehow, maybe because of the influence from the outside culture. We want to, maybe it is the influence of Bollywood, you never know.
Yeah, maybe because we want to be cool, you know, and we think that talking English is being cool. So maybe. That is one thing.
But that does not happen in other countries. You're right in saying that when you talk to other people from other countries, they don't have this thing in them that they have to impress you with their English. But when we do that, somehow we have this feeling that we want to impress. And I used to have that feeling in myself a lot, which I am trying to curb down a little. Okay, all right, fine. That was amazing. That was one very good answer. I'm sure a lot of people are going to benefit out of it. I'll come to my next question, which I've forgotten. Okay. How much does YouTube pay you? But difficult question. Very difficult question.
And I know how well you dodged it when I was interviewing you, and I am going to do the same thing. Don't worry.
No. Give me a little ballpark figure. Do not give me exact, because there is no exact actually. It fluctuates. We know
that. It fluctuates. It fluctuates video to video. Mm-hmm. But I would say that if you are having, so right now I have 75,000 subscribers, close to that. If you are having 75,000 subscribers, it is not sufficient. How much YouTube pays is not sufficient for you to run your show. I mean, for you to run your life. So it is that bad. And initially, as you are also aware, initially there were times when you wouldn't even get the minimum wages that a laborer gets. It's less than that even now, for as a matter of fact, in many months when your videos don't do good. So yes, you need to really improve, or you need to have a good viewer base in order to make a living out of your YouTube money. It's growing. It grows. That is the good part, that once it starts growing, slowly and steadily it will grow. And
it is an
you
asset.
Will start earning. Yeah, it is an asset. It is an asset. It is a good source of passive income, especially when you're just doing it out of hobby and you're doing it as an add-on. But if you want to make it make a career out of it, then it will take some time and it'll take some patience. So in short, how much do I get in a month? Maybe some months, I can get around 5,000, 10,000. In some months, it might be a little more. In some months, it might be a little less. Sometimes after 2 months, I get $100. So it's all fluctuating.
It fluctuates. I agree. You can never depend on your income from this platform, because it fluctuates like crazy. You have absolutely no fix coming from it, right?
Yeah, and I think the thing about YouTubing in India is it pays a lot less than what it does in the US. So if a viewer watches you from the US, then your rate, whatever they call it, CPM and whatever technical terms, it is much higher than what you are seeing when a viewer watches you in India. And for me, predominantly, everybody is an Indian who's watching or from the subcontinent, India, Nepal, Pakistan,
Bangladesh.
Right. So the rates are always less.
Something really nice to share over here. Just recently, my viewer base has also started to come from abroad. Earlier, it was mostly India. More than 90% traffic was from India. But now it has started to come from 30% or maybe more. 30-35% of my traffic is coming from outside. And I can see a change in the money that I'm making.
Yes,
you're right in that. You're right. When the traffic comes from abroad, you make more money. That is true.
Yes. Abroad, especially when it is Europe or US, Asia is all very bad, because I have many from the UAE and Pakistan, Bangladesh watching, but then it still doesn't
pay. And I think that happens, that is easier if your videos are in a universal language. When you're making videos in English, maybe.
If you're speaking in English, you need to be patient. Ki haan, you will slowly get that crowd and then you will grow.
There's no denial about it. You are going to make money even if you make Hindi videos. It's just that probably it's going to take a little longer. Because of obviously Hindi videos, people from America will not be able to understand.
But on the other side, if you see most of the famous Indian YouTubers, the ones who have the highest rankings, they are all Hindi speakers. All their channels are in Hindi.
India definitely has the highest number. Right? So you do get good subscribers when you make Hindi videos. Okay, we'll come to the next question. Interesting question. Are you a business guy or you're a service guy? What do you see yourself in the long run? Would you be running a business or would you be doing a job at a good position? Of course, you're already doing well in life. I'm sure you're going to be sitting at a high position if you continue with your job. But what is the plan in future? Because again, a lot of students want to get this thing also cleared for them. They are very confused right now.
It's a very difficult question. You know, it's like what I have been doing versus whether I want to do something else or not. Honestly speaking, so in my entire family, my father is the only person who's actually been into service. I mean, he's working and I am also working, and almost everybody else is in business. But the thing that I like very much about continuing to work, in a corporate setup for somebody else, as people might call it, that you're working for somebody else. No, not really. You're working for yourself. You're working for your own development. You are getting that growth, and you are putting only that much effort which is expected out of you. You know what you want, you are getting what you want, and you're satisfied with that. It has a lot of advantages that, you know, the risk is limited. Of course, if the risk is limited, then the rewards are also limited. Maybe if I put those 10, 12 hours in my business, I would have done double of what, or double of that, but the risk would have been double. Now, what I've started enjoying about the corporate setup or corporate life, it is taxing, of course, but, you know, at the end of the week, you are at your home, relaxed, not worried about, okay, there's a pandemic now, my business is shut, what will I do? I don't know. Or you, it can happen in job also that you might be out of your job because of this, but then still there is some hope that you will get some other job. A
certain figure that is going to credit in your account at the end of the day, right?
Exactly. You have that surety. And now I have started liking that professionalism, the whole concept of professionalism, which does not come in business, especially, you know, if you're doing small businesses or trading. Yes, maybe what I would definitely say is it's always a pleasure to have something that you are able to control. And that is why I love YouTubing so much.
You've divided your life in a very good, it's a cocktail. You generally give most of your hours to your job. And then at the end of the day, you want to do something for yourself in that manner, that I want to create an asset, create a business of my own. And that is why you started with YouTube. I think you've done a very sensible thing over here.
Honestly speaking, I know I don't have business acumen. I cannot go and negotiate with people. I'll always quote a lesser price and I'll come. So I'm not going to do that in my life for sure, as for a living at least.
I get it. And I would want to say this to you, and I really genuinely mean it, that when you're speaking, and I'm looking at you speaking right now on my computer screen, all I can think of is that somebody is giving me a really nice presentation. I think you're that presentation guy. Right.
I'm also a teacher, so that also, you know, comes in. Plus, I'm the presentation guy. So yes, it's a combination of both.
No, you really present well. Your body language is quite complimentary to what you're speaking. It not much hand movements. The way I dance my hands too much when I talk, and I see that your hands are very much in your control when you're talking. And the focus really goes on your words when you're speaking, which I like, I appreciate, probably something for me to learn from you. I'll then come to next question. Oh yeah, something that you would love to answer, your hardships in life.
Okay, I genuinely feel...
Pre-CA.
See, I genuinely feel, I don't know, you know, I'm not trying to sound too philosophical, or I'm not trying to sound too godly. But I generally feel that everybody has challenges in life. Everybody has hardships. For example, if we talk about pre-CA times, or when I started doing chartered accountancy, of course, every new step that you take is a hardship. You open that book for the first time, it is difficult. You fail in your examination. So for the first time I ever failed in my life was in a CA exam. So that is a hardship. But then when you are, you know, going through those hardships, you think of a relative that, okay, I am going through this hardship. Is there somebody else who is in a worse situation than mine, or in an even bad position than mine? Maybe somebody is not even getting this chance to do chartered accountancy. So then you just count your blessings. Thank for what you have. For me, genuine hardships are only two: either you're not having food to eat, or you're not having home to live. If that is your condition, then you are in a hardship. Otherwise, I think everything else is manageable, because all of our families, I'm sure it must be the same with you, and it's the same with me. All of our families have come in from villages, have really worked hard to reach where they are. The two of us are recording this video while, unfortunately, a lot of people are in a difficult situation. That is a true challenge. I mean, if my subscribers don't increase tomorrow, or my views are not too high, that is not a challenge for me. I mean, it's just happening. It's happening. Also, I mean, I would like to add over here, every small thing can have something big in it. For example, I don't think too many of my YouTube followers know it. I have got an opportunity to speak at the TED, so I'll be giving a TED talk soon. And as a matter of fact, it was supposed to happen in April in the US, but then it got postponed because of the entire COVID thing.
And what are you going to speak at? What are you going to speak about?
This is the best part. I'm going to speak about my YouTube channel.
I didn't put that in my title of the video.
Yeah, you can do that. I mean, I haven't done it yet. I just posted a picture as of now on my YouTube channel.
I have got an opportunity on your WhatsApp image.
Yeah, exactly. It's there. So that was from the TED headquarters. We went there for a training session on how to speak and what really you need to communicate in your speech.
That was where the headquarters. Where were they?
In New York.
Wow.
So I just went in before the COVID thing exploded and I came back and then of course it got postponed. Now it will be happening virtually, but it will be happening. So I'm excited about it. And I mean, that was something which really showed me that it doesn't matter what your numbers talk, it's your intent that you are trying to help somebody, because the whole concept is how the free classes that I've uploaded on my channel for CA students has helped them. A lot of students comment that, sir, we were very poor, but because of your classes, we have cleared. Oh. We have got 60 plus in strategic management. We have got 60 plus in audit. Parents have commented that, really God bless you that, you are doing such a thing. The subscriber base for me, I know, will never really skyrocket because mine is a niche topic. It doesn't matter because it's the satisfaction at the end of the day that you're getting out of what you're doing. And I really hope I'll be able to
continue. To this, I am very proud of what you're doing. I really support. And as a teacher myself, I do understand that not every student is in a position to pay for those very, very expensive classes. I have taken them myself. And I remember when I took those classes, my family was not really in a position to pay for those classes. And I remember how my father used to run his household supporting my education when I was doing my classes. And I'm whatever I am is because of him. I know not everybody is in that position. Hats off to you. If you're doing that, you are doing an amazing job. And honestly, I had not known about those free classes. I'm going to look them up.
You should. I mean, that was how I started my transition from being a random serial reviewer kind of a channel to a pathway to CA kind of a channel. That set the base. Now, unfortunately, I'll have to admit that the pace has slowed down because as I increase my service responsibilities, my work responsibilities, the frequency of me spending time, because you know it well, you are a teacher, how much time it takes to construct one lesson. You have to learn, you have to read, you have to be thorough in it, you have to record, you have to process, you have to upload. It takes, for me, one class used to take almost 1.5-2 weeks because of my office and this entire process. So now it has slowed down a bit, unfortunately, but I just hope that I'll restart doing it.
I really feel, Arihant, that the speed is not much of value when you are continuously doing something. Your speed may be less, your speed may be more, but if you do not give up and you continue your path, yeah, I think you are in that journey of you reaching where you want to reach. You're going to affect, I don't know, touch how many lives, 1 million lives or so, maybe more than that. But seriously, very well done. Good job.
Thank you. And just one thing, maybe if I just want to add, in terms of hardships, when do hardships come? When you have a lot of expectations out of yourself. So when I started my YouTube channel, my expectation was just one, that even if one student is getting benefited, I think I'm happy. And even now I maintain that if even one student is happy out of what he or she is seeing on my channel, I think it's job done for me. So yeah, I'm content. I'm saintly when it comes to being content.
You know what? When I began with this interview, I really did not know that I'm going to be so touched with this interview. I am really touched. I am very happy that I interviewed you. And there is definitely a lot to learn from you. I don't really have any more stuff to ask you, but I did enjoy these 23, 24 minutes of our talk. And I'm sure, I don't think I have much to edit over here. I'm just going to upload it as it is. Thank you very much. I enjoyed the talk. And we are wishing you all the best for your TED talk.
Thank you so much. I'm nervous about it. But yes, I'm sure I'll do a good job.
You will kill it, I'm sure. All right, Arihant. So I think time to go. And I'm very excited for this upload. I really hope this goes well. And once you become that TED talker, you come back, we'll give you an interview once, all over once again to me.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. Maybe as an exclusive TED speaker, I can come and I can share my experience. I will definitely do that on my channel as well. But of course,
this is my first time interviewing or maybe talking to somebody who has this experience of TED. You've been on TED. Come on, you've been on TED, right?
I've been there.
This is going to be your second time. So this is my first time talking to somebody who's been on TED. Amazing. Very nice. Congratulations. All the best. And hope to keep in touch with you.
Absolutely. Thank you so much, Alina. Have a good day.
Okay. Bye-bye. Take care.